I speak in the name of the living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen. Be seated. Before COVID, I would regularly make a retreat at a very restful and peaceful convent up in Catonsville, Maryland. It's a community called the All Saints Sisters of the Poor. Maybe some of you have heard of it. They have really wonderful little cards that they sell. They're Catholic now, but they used to be Anglican, and they're known not only for their warm hospitality to retreatants, but also for the seriousness with which they embrace the traditional monastic life. When you walk in the front door of their convent, you'll see printed in great big letters on the wall above the central hallway a Latin phrase, Nihil abentes omnia possidentes. Nihil abentes omnia possidentes. Any Latin students out there from high school, maybe? Having nothing, yet possessing everything. Having nothing, yet possessing everything. The sisters live a common life together, which means that each of them has voluntarily embraced the renunciation of personal ownership. They've renounced having. They've done this because they believe that by subordinating their own desire for material things to their shared lifestyle of prayer, work, and hospitality, they will in fact each come to possess much more than they otherwise ever could have had. That's the logic of Christian monasticism. It's never about saying that food or sex or material things are bad in themselves. It's about subordinating these good things to an even greater good. It's about trying to come to see them, see with more clarity and sobriety the one good thing that is the source of all other good things, the ultimate thing that is God. It's about coming to possess everything precisely by giving everything to Him. In the economy of the kingdom, you can only keep what you have given away. That's the basic principle underlying that. St. Paul knew this principle well, though he experienced it in a very different form than a peaceful monastic retreat. Paul gave away much more than just his material ownership of things. His mission required him to undergo a disorienting onslaught of external trials and pressures that he willingly endured for the sake of the vocation which the Lord had given him. He describes in our epistle that was just read a moment ago, 2 Corinthians, the lifestyle that he had been living for the sake of fulfilling that mission. Through great endurance, he said, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, tumults, labors, sleepless nights, hunger. And yet, listen to what he goes on to say about his experience of these hardships. We are treated as imposters, and yet are true, as unknown and yet well-known, as dying and behold we live, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing yet possessing everything. There it is. Paul learned the hard way that the goods of this world are transient and unstable. His elite religious status and social favor as a Pharisee plummeted to widespread rejection and misunderstanding by his Jewish brethren when he embraced the Lord Jesus. His health was crippled by what he called a thorn in his side that he always carried around with him. Even his churches were rarely the site of serene reliability, given the conflicts he regularly had to mend. And yet it was precisely through what he suffered that he began to taste the one thing that is actually true and stable and reliable. We can hear in the background of his letters, of his epistles, we can hear Paul saying something like this: I am misunderstood, even by those closest to me, my brethren, according to the flesh, my Jewish brethren. I am misunderstood, but I am known by God. My outward body and everything around me feels like it's decaying, but inwardly I'm being renewed day by day. My circumstances are intensely sorrowful, and yet there is a fire deep in my soul that will consume all of this sadness, the fire of divine joy. I have nothing on earth to call my own, but because I am held by God, what that matters could I ever really lack? Having nothing, he possessed everything. We gather today at the beginning of this great and holy season of Lent to refocus ourselves on an essential principle in the Christian life and Christian faith. Every created thing, sun and moon, nation and kingdom, tower and temple, food and family, even you and me, all of it is fundamentally dust. Every single thing that exists, Christians believe, came from nothing, and its intrinsic orientation is always to tend back towards the nothingness from which it came. That doesn't mean that created things are bad or worthless. In fact, it means the exact opposite. The only reason anything continues to exist at all is because God, in his goodness, generously preserves the good things he has made, continuously pours being into them at every moment, and holds his hand always underneath them to keep them from falling into the abyss. Every created thing is a gift of God's goodness, a token of his generosity and love, a reminder that God knows what we need before we ask, like the air that we're breathing right now, that God is constantly pouring into our lungs. All of it's a gift. All of it's a token of his love. The fact that every created thing is dust doesn't mean that created things are bad. What it means is that they are not God. And that's the thing. That's the whole story of human sin. From day one until this very hour, as St. Paul said, our basic sin is that we have worshiped and served the creature rather than the creator. What does that mean? Well, it means that from the very beginning, we human beings have tried to find the goal and the reason for our lives in things that were supposed to be secondary. We've tried to locate the stable home where we can finally rest our weary hearts in way stations that were never made to supply that rest. God made us with hearts too expansive, with desires too intense, with such a potential for infinite joy that no finite transient good will ever really satisfy us. In God alone will we be safe. In God alone will we find our rest. In God alone will the deepest desires of our hearts be satisfied, and much more. It's not so hard to see how we make this mistake. About 15 years ago, I walked what's called the Camino de Santiago in Spain to Santiago de Compostela, the Cathedral of St. James. It's a long and exhausting journey, but there are many happy consolations along the way. You walk through a number of really beautiful cities and towns in northern Spain, often with gorgeously arrayed medieval cathedrals or lively town squares with festive music and children playing football, that is, soccer, late into the night. And nearly always, in every place you go, with warm hospitality from locals who have been receiving pilgrims for over a millennium. After a long day of walking on this pilgrimage, when I had found a pleasant place to stay in one of these towns or cities, it was hard for me not to think, as I sat there at a cozy inn with a full stomach and a warm bed awaiting me, it was hard for me not to think, you know, it might be nice to just spend the rest of my trip right here. Why should I put myself through the grueling pain of getting up tomorrow morning before dawn and starting to trek out along the way to the end of the road? But of course, that never would have worked. The warm hospitality of the locals was designed for a particular purpose, with established limits. After about day two, I would have worn out my welcome. I would have tried to take from these kind and good locals something they were never meant to give. The only thing for me to do was to give thanks for the brief moment of rest and refreshment that they provided, and then put my head down and continue along the way. That's what this life is like. When we try to hold on too tight to the things of this world, even the very best of things, like the rest and refreshment of warm hospitality, when we try to grip them as though our whole being and happiness depended on them, they will crumble in our hands. Not because they're bad, but because they were never made for that pressure. When we try to have them, we wind up actually possessing nothing. But when instead we give them back to God in thanks and praise for the good consolation that He has temporarily lent to us, then we come really to possess them, because we have them in Him. Having nothing, we will possess everything. None of this is so hard to believe, of course, as war reminds us, in a way that not even a global pandemic can, that everything we think we know to be stable and reliable and firm is actually fragile and tentative and provisional. All the more reason for us to take to heart the words of our Lord in the Gospel. Jesus spells out in Matthew 6, our Gospel reading for Ash Wednesday, what the church has traditionally taken to be the three basic Lenten disciplines: almsgiving, prayer, and fasting. And it has often been observed that Jesus simply assumes that these are things that everyone will be doing in some form or another. He doesn't say if you give alms or if you fast or if you pray, but when you give alms, when you fast, when you pray. There are lots of different ways to do these things, of course, and everyone has to discern what fits best for their own circumstances, their own conditions in life, their own capacities and state of life and all of that. The key point, though, is that Lent is a golden opportunity for refocusing ourselves on the one and only thing that we know to be certain, by chastening our tendency to lean on the things that are not. When you give alms, you surrender your control over the money that God has entrusted into your hands, and taking your stand on God's promise to take care of you, you recognize that you're going to be okay, regardless of what's in your bank account. When you set aside time exclusively dedicated to prayer, you're implicitly affirming that even if you put off your work for 30 minutes, it's going to be okay, because God is in control even of your labors. And when you fast, the pangs of hunger acutely remind you that you depend on something outside of yourself. You're not self-created or self-sustaining. And it actually enables you to receive food with much more gratitude and enjoyment, because it teaches you not to take it for granted. Of course, as Jesus also reminds us, if we're taking on any of these disciplines merely as a way of looking or feeling more pious, then they are worse than useless. The whole point of them is coming to recognize where our true treasure really lies. Our Father in heaven sees us and knows us and loves us. That's a possession that neither moth nor rust will ever consume. All of us one day will have nothing. Remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. But if we use this season well, it will open our eyes to the heavenly treasury in which we can possess everything, in the love of God that will never fail us nor forsake us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.